Hi, I'm Lisa Bisbee, and I am reading Art and Man by Edwin Swift Balch and Eugenia Macfarlane Balch. The book was published in 1918, and it's in the public domain. Chapter 4, The Personal Equation of an Artist, Sincerity, Personality, Style, Observation, Imagination, and Memory. Soyez naïf, cherchez bien, les masses were two of the favorite sayings of my first painting teacher, Henri Marcet of Spa, Belgium, and they are sayings which might well be taken to heart by all painters. For what the French convey in the word naivete is an important element in a work of art. Unfortunately, there is no exact equivalent in English for the French word naïf, as used by Henri Marcet. It can be paraphrased in the adjectives sincere, genuine, natural, truthful, individual, personal, instinctive, spontaneous, straightforward, but none of them renders absolutely Marcet's thought. What he meant, however, was that you should look at nature and paint what you see in your own way without regard to any traditions or anyone else's work. Naivete means that an artist allows his art instinct to express himself untrammeled by convention. And when he does so, his individuality crops out. His work shows freshness and is not quite like any other artwork. There are three main stages in an artist's life. When he is a child, he is sincere, and his one desire is to put down and express something that he sees or some idea in his head. He works hard to do this, and the result, even if shapeless, is at least genuine and is not a copy of someone else. And then comes his period of training. In this, he is pretty sure to follow others. In fact, he can hardly help doing so. Whether working in an academy or with one master, he is bound to be more or less influenced by his education and to do copying rather than original work. He may never get beyond this stage in which he may leave his freshness or personality behind, except to gain more ease of expression and continuing to follow others. His natural development may be arrested. But if he is strong enough, after having acquired technical knowledge through his training, he may throw traditions to the wind and obey only his own youthful art instincts. In that case, he probably becomes a real artist, a leader. Excellent examples of sincere, genuine personality can be found in many of the works of the early Italian and Flemish painters. Giotto, Piero della Francesco, Pinturicchio, the Van Eycks, Memling, etc. These men did not know everything. They had few pictures around them to lean on. They had to forge ahead for themselves and do things as they felt them. In other words, they were thoroughly naïf, and their work has enduring freshness. An exact contrast to the work of the early Italian and Flemish painters is found in that of their imitators, the English Pre-Raphaelites. The early Italians and Flemish were striving to do the best they could. They used all their knowledge. They moved steadily forward towards later art. The Pre-Raphaelites were trying to go backwards. They left out knowledge, which was already a common possession, in an attempt to attain the qualities which the Italians and the Flemish got through lack of knowledge. Their work was not genuine, it was imitation. It is like the modern printed tapestry as compared with the old original article. The result was that the Pre-Raphaelite machine skidded into the ditch. Some of the most artistic artwork in the world, nevertheless, has been done by one of the least naïf of the races, the Chinese. Probably the same rule applies with them as with us. that the best work is yet done when an artist has been thoroughly trained, yet is strong enough to cause his individuality to stand out above his training. But I suspect that a good deal of Chinese art is conventional, precisely from the lack of sincerity among the lesser men, causing a loss of spontaneity in their productions. The art of primitive races depends for its strength partly on its freshness and sincerity. It stands to advanced Europeans or East Asiatic art somewhat in the same relation that the scribblings of an artistic child could do to his matured work. European and East Asiatic art show greater intellect, knowing, and training than primitive art, but they sometimes lack its freshness and sincerity, acting freely without much knowledge or training. Much of it is real art, even though often undeveloped. Lots of the art of primitive races, in truth, is ever so much better than much of the art of civilized races. Primitive men, for instance, do not know enough to ruin their instinctive desire for vivid colors, and they frequently instinctively make pretty things. While civilized men, reasoning and putting intellect into the work, make ugly stuff. Sincerity alone, however, without the artistic instinct, is useless in art. Of the Africans have plenty of sincerity, and they are all, in fact, all sincere, and nevertheless, much of their art is inartistic. So this guy says, not me, this guy. This is possibly because apparently many Negroes, can you believe he just said this? This is 1918. I don't even know if I can read this. This is possibly because, you know, sometimes his opinion just doesn't matter. I'm not even going to bother reading that sentence. Sincerity is the only other mental trait urging the art instinct to work freely. It does not take place of the art instinct if this is wanting. Personality or individuality is closely associated with sincerity, and again is closely associated with style. Personality is practically synonymous with individuality, and both terms are used about an artist when he puts enough of himself into his work for it to be recognized as his work at a glance. Every strong artist has his own personal way of working, which is in his style, and this becomes just as recognizable to an expert as a man's handwriting. Style is an expression of the artist's taste, and it is mainly from the individual style that an expert can often see at a glance who it was painted a picture. For art is like handwriting. It is not a mechanical performance like printing or photography. And like handwriting, art is carried out by the hand in obedience to an impulse from the brain. And as a result, art reveals character just as does handwriting. Style is found in all arts. Style applies to both schools of art and to individual artists. It means the special manner in which a work of art is carried out. That is, it refers to the technique. When a number of works of art come from some one place, an epoch, they are designated as a school. All glyptic arts from all places, all schools of art have their individual style. And by much observation and comparison, one may become able to tell almost with certainty to what art any piece belongs and where it came from. With personality, it is different. In modern European and in East Asiatic art, we can often tell from the work the name of the artist. In some other arts, like South Asiatic, we can do so occasionally, but in many arts, such as the African, Australasian, and American arts, we cannot do so at all. Personality in art, it must be added, refers only to the work and not to the moral or mental character of an artist. He may be a good man or a bad man, a sensible one or a foolish one, but his work rarely gives any clue on which to form a judgment. Many popular notions about artists, however, are entirely erroneous. The great majority of artists are perfectly decent citizens, and the amount of labor they are forced to do to forge ahead prevents their being anything else. Observation undoubtedly is at the bottom of all art. Artists sculpted and drew and painted in the beginning what they actually saw. They worked from the animals they knew. They sculpted and painted the forms and the features of their own race. Enlarged ears or small waists or long fingernails in art imply that they originated in fact. Observation underlies not only all sculptural and pictorial art, but also most decorative art, for this is based on human, animal, and plant forms, or on basketry patterns. And in nearly all cases, it starts in observation, which, when accurate, is personal and sincere. A good example of this principle is offered by the fabulous animals which are found in many arts all over the globe. So many artists in so many places could not have dreamed them. They must have started in something actually seen. And the only apparent solution is that the animal headed humans and humans headed animals. Animal-headed humans and human-headed animals originated in hunting disguises, which, while such an unnatural beastie as the Chinese dragons, was an invention made from animals which had been observed, an artistic evolution from the crocodiles and pythons, or possibly even from now extinct reptiles, which had scared the artist's forefathers. Everything, therefore, actually represented in art must be assumed to be based on something the artist or his ancestors actually saw. Artists did not dream first, underlying any use of the imagination or the memory. There was an observation of things around the artist. Art is thus a record of ethnology, of zoology, of botany, of customs, and of history. Nevertheless, imagination, invention, and memory are important vital factors in an artist's makeup. But little good art is produced without their help. The idea commonly accepted among Europeans that all sculpture, drawing, and painting must be done while looking directly at nature is a fallacy, based on equally prevalent fallacy that art must be true to nature, must be a photographic imitation of her. It is a fact, on the contrary, that great painters and sculptors often work largely from memory or imagination. They either make studies until they know their subject, or they look at it until they memorize it, or they invent. Memory and imagination are of perhaps greatest value in obtaining life and motion and fleeting effects of color and light. And when a work of art is produced to some extent from memory or imagination, the figures are seldom wooden and rarely posing. But when it is not so produced, the life is often arrested, and the figures seem petrified and are merely models in an unhappy state of rest. Imagination, invention, and memory are more or less present in all good art. In European art, hundreds of artists may be cited as exponents of these qualities. Giotto, Fra Angelico, Pisano, Tintoretto, Michelangelo, Turner, Buchlin, Millet, Boutet de Montvel, Charest, William Morris Hunt, George Inez, etc. The Chinese and Japanese masters of all painted almost entirely from memory and imagination, but the artists of other races also show these same qualities. The Pleistocenes certainly had them, for how otherwise could they have painted their wall pictures at Altamira and Fondegum in dark caverns whose only access is a tiny opening no bison nor mammoth could possibly have squeezed through. And the Bushmen and the Eskimo certainly have capital memories, and some other races whose art is less realistic, such as the Melanesians of New Ireland with their strange figures, or the Alaskans with their totem poles, or the Polynesians with their wood carvings, or the Arabs with their patterns and arabesques. Events, liveliest imagination and invention in producing strange, original, beautiful works of art. Okay, on to the next chapter next time. Have a good day.